Well, we're grateful, Christy and I are grateful to be here, to be able to talk about really the illusion of the American dream. And we really want to thank the Mainses for inviting us here, along with the Lounsberries. Steve and Carrie are old friends of ours for about 20 years from now. But we really wanted to come and we've been asked to share our stories. And that's what we plan on doing. Because we want you to hear from our very lives what we experienced. And we experienced much of what people desire in the American dream. But what we want you to know is that that American dream is such an illusion. And it ends in so much heartache if you are not aware. And there's a passage in the scriptures that Paul actually wrote. And I appreciate Paul because he shared his story many times in scripture. And he shared in Philippians chapter 3. He actually shared that all of the things in his life at one point that he considered everything were human credentials and acts of his flesh. And he even goes on to list all of the great things he's done. But you know what? He comes to the conclusion that all of those things might have been assets at one time, but he considered them liabilities because he surpassed the surpassing greatness of knowing Jesus. And that's what we've experienced. But it's a process, and we want to share with you the process. How did we get to a place where we had a lot, but we at some point considered it worth nothing compared to a relationship with the living God through Jesus Christ? And I wanted to first give my wife a chance to share. But before she shares, I thought it might be cool for you to get a glimpse into her life when she was closer to maybe many of your age.
Take over. Well, I know everyone here is ready. Are you two young ladies ready?
She'll get it one day, but right now, it's just in us, you know, it's just in us to want the good life. And I grew up very religious in a small town in Mississippi, went to church every Sunday, had things, ups and downs in our childhood, my childhood, like we all do. For the most part, it was a great, simple life growing up, in a middle-class family, plenty of love, but there was something in me that was ambitious, that wanted more. And my mom really encouraged that. She would tell me things like, you don't have to marry the president, you can be the president. That's my mom. And I was such a dreamer. I've always been such a dreamer. And I wanted to do something great with my life. So I worked hard, I got all A's. I worked hard in sports. I was on the starting five of a 3-year run state championship basketball team. About to put that in there. I was a national baton twirler, title holder 5 times. I know you're really impressed with that. But I worked hard. And then I had the opportunity to be in the Miss Mississippi Team USA pageant. Miss Mississippi USA pageant, so team. So I was in that, I ended up winning. And so then I went on to be in the Miss Teen USA pageant. And then God's plan, I won that. So the next day, next morning, I'm on the Today Show. I'm signing a contract with Paramount Pictures, flying to LA. I'm ushered into my new temporary home, which was a penthouse on Wilshire Boulevard, and Miss Universe and Miss USA were there to meet me, my new roommates, as their little sister. We traveled around the nation together and out of the country, modeling for companies like Maybelline, and just had a life. We had a white limo for the day, black limo at night, you name it. And soon after my reign began, I started to look in the mirror and hate what I saw. And by the world's beauty standards, I saw every flaw, and I saw every imperfection, and I saw every extra pound, and I really experienced what happens when your looks become your identity. And it totally backfires. And I was so insecure. And I really didn't feel like loved for me, or even known, and appreciated for who I really was. And I started medicating with food. And this eating disorder went on for years that developed during that year. And only God helped me to overcome it eventually one day after He saved my life. But I would order, I remember traveling, I might go to some great public appearance or party and go back to the hotel room and order every dessert on the room service menu and just make myself sick. And I didn't feel skinny enough or good enough or smart enough. And it was so disillusioned. And I just felt like, why? Like, this is what I dreamed of. This is the fairy tale, and I'm 16 and I have everything. Why? Why am I so unhappy? And I felt like, you know, the thing probably missing is to be in love. Maybe that's what I'm missing. And I had a deep need to be loved, like we all do. And so I set my sights on someone, and I compromised my standards and my morals to pursue this love. And at that point... yes. By that point, I had received a full scholarship to Ole Miss, academic scholarship. And so at that point, I was going to school there, and what people on campus knew me as was just a girl that was in a great sorority, was on the Dean's Honor Roll, pursuing a double major. I was a featured twirler for the Ole Miss Marching Band, and a Rebelette dancer for the basketball team. As voted most beautiful, was on the homecoming court, all that stuff. But behind closed doors, I was so miserable. And my life was completely out of control. And I had compromised and given my soul away to this relationship in this last ditch effort to find whatever I was searching for. And at the rock bottom, I found myself putting makeup over my black eye to go to class. Drugs, partying, and I would look in the mirror again and just hate what I saw. I remember one night running out after a huge fight, my boyfriend's house, out the backyard, and just falling in the wet grass, curling up in a ball. I'll never forget that moment, and just saying, God, help me. I don't know if I said it or if I thought it, but at that point, God reached down. He took hold of my life, and He had a plan and a dream for me. Not long after that, I got out my childhood Bible, I sat down, and it fell to Galatians 5:19. Didn't know where I was going to read. It fell there. Yeah. Which talks about a lifestyle that pleases God and one that doesn't. And I knew at that point, very clearly, another moment I'll never forget, that I had to make a choice.
Similar to Christy, I grew up with really my mom primarily. Christy had grown up with the product of a divorced home, and so did I. My parents' marriage only lasted 4 years. My mom gave birth to me as a freshman in college. And so I grew up, and my mom had made a decision. And she decided that education for me was going to be my way out. And so as a young person, she instilled in me that if you're going to achieve anything in life, And Christy wanted to be pretty and smart and rich. My mom really instilled in me to be powerful, smart, and rich. And that was what everything was all about. And she impressed upon me the importance of education. In fact, she took me out of the school I was in fifth grade because I was making too good of grades. And she said, "You're not being challenged enough." I'm like, "Dude, are you kidding me? Who gets kicked out of school for making straight A's?" You know what I mean? So she put me into a school that was known for its rigorous academic standards. And even to this day, it's one of the top private schools in Texas. And so I went to this school totally out of the, I didn't know anybody at the school. I was one of four black guys in my entire class, not many minorities on the whole campus. And it was a shock to everything in me. But over time, my mom taught me how to act. And she said, "Jeff, you're a minority. You're gonna have to be twice as good as everybody else to get half as far. So you better work hard." And I worked hard at that school. I started in sixth grade, and by the time I graduated, I really had done well in school. I had done well in sports as well. And I had the privilege of, even at my graduation, to be given the honor for the school founder. They have an award named after him every year. They gave that to me. And so after that, I went on to Princeton University. And there I was able to experience a lot of the, what I thought was the American dream. I mean, this is an incredible group of students. I mean, it was amazing. But I learned some really bad habits when I went to Princeton. And some of the bad habits I learned were, hey, you know, you can party and still do well in school. Well, let me show that I can go out Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, and still pull A's and B's. And it was a dangerous game, really, I was playing. And there were a group of friends of mine, and that we really committed ourselves to working hard, but playing hard too. And that was a culture that I developed while at Princeton. And it developed intensely to the point of drug use, sexual immorality, and things I'm absolutely not proud of at this point. And right after college, I got a job with Oracle. I sat down in my interview, and the guy looked at me and he said, "The only reason why I'm about to give you this job, even though you're underqualified, the only reason I'm gonna give you this job is because you went to Princeton. I think you can figure it out." And he gave me the job. And I worked my tail off at that job. Same stuff I'd been doing before. And by the time I was 25 years old, I was making six figures. And I was promoted. And I was the number one sales rep for my product at the company. And I was dating someone. And I thought, man, this is the person that I'm going to marry. This is great. I got me a good job. I'm powerful. I'm smart. Ivy League degree. I got money in my pocket. Driving a red sports car. Got me a woman. Cool. And somebody knocked on the door, and it was my girlfriend who told, she was informing me that she would no longer need my services anymore. And I'm thinking, wait a minute, I just got dumped. And I'll never forget. It rocked my world. It shook me up. And I remember going outside, and I went for a walk. I never walked. I never went on walks. And I just sat there and said, what just happened? My whole life is being shattered right now. I thought I had the plan. I had everything I thought I wanted. And what I realized is, I felt this feeling that I didn't know what to do with it. It was a pain, but it was a numbness. And what I realized, I had never dealt with my heart. I had never dealt with what was going on in my heart. And what I know now, I wish I knew then, is one time Jesus said something to a group of religious leaders, and he called them hypocrites. And you know what he told him? He said, "Man, you're messed up. All you worry about is the outside of the cup. You don't clean the inside of your cup. Because inside the cup, it's filled with greed and self-indulgence, but you don't care. You just worry about the outside of the cup." And that's the story of my life. I spent all that time on the outside of my cup, wanting to look so good for everybody and so to receive so much praise from people. But all of a sudden, I realized that I had never dealt with my heart. And I was hollow and I was hurting. And you know, that's the issue I want you to think about. If your dreams are built on your identity is built on things that can be taken away from you, and if your dreams are built on never examining the nature of your heart, then you one day will wake up in a nightmare. Wow. I guarantee you. Christy was describing a moment where she didn't know where she was going to go, and there I was on that walk, and I didn't know where I was going to go either. But we both needed the same person. We didn't need something. We needed someone desperately to help us. And that one person, you know who he is. I wanted to show a clip if it'll work, because to me, this kind of sums up what Christy and I both needed in our lives at that time.
We're all Jews. How can they live for themselves? Our own people working for Rome. These people make me sick.
Collaborators, let's move on.
A stinking vermin. You should keep your distance.
Two men went to the temple to pray. One a Pharisee, and the other one a tax collector. The Pharisee prayed, "God, I thank you that I'm not like other men, thieves, adulterers, or this tax collector. But the tax collector didn't even look up to heaven. He said, God, have mercy on me. I'm a sinner." God blessed the tax collector, not the Pharisee. Anyone who praises himself for be humbled, and anyone who humbles himself will be praised.
Matthew, come.
To get me to that point where I needed to be broken. And like Jeff talked about, I needed to see what was in my heart and how badly I needed Jesus. In that moment when my Bible fell to Galatians 5 and I saw clearly the choice in front of me, the phone rang. And it was a friend of mine from LA. And she said, "My lease is up soon. I want to know if you want to move in with me. And I know you had talked about moving back to LA after college." I said, "Yes." It was amazing how God started putting the ducks in a row. And so I got the strength, cut off my relationship, graduated from Ole Miss with honors, and I moved to LA. And I was so excited about this new life that God was going to help me have. I started praying, and I started praying a lot. And the cool thing is that at the exact same time, somebody else was praying a lot for me too. And it was someone that had never met me before. It was someone that was praying, "God, the women in LA need you so badly. Use me to meet a woman that needs you, and use me to help her change her life and get to know you. And she was praying specific prayers that God put on her heart so that he could blow her faith away in the way that God loves to do. She was praying that she would meet someone who was new in town, that was a model, that had blonde hair, that had an accent. I kid you not. So one night, my roommate and I went to the yogurt, frozen yogurt store for dinner, because that's what we did for dinner. And I was just standing in line, and this girl that I'd never met before invited me out to church. And I said, yes, I'm looking for a church. And I felt like, oh, you know, this is what I've been praying for. But even though that's what I said and that's what I felt, it took me 5 months to get to church. And I stood her up every single week because the world had its grip in me so tightly. And there was still this part of the world that just pulled at me, even though I knew it's not an easy process, like he said earlier. You know, God was fighting for me, but Satan was fighting for me too. And one day, she told me the story later, it was communion. She was praying, and she prayed, God, this is the last prayer I'm going to pray for Christy. Please bring someone into my life that really wants to know you. And as soon as she said those words in her mind, the usher tapped her on the shoulder and said, your friend's waiting in the lobby. And from that point, the rest is really history. She asked me to study the Bible, and I saw Jesus for the first time. I mean, I grew up going to church, but I mean, I really saw him for the first time, not on a necklace, not on an Easter special, but I saw this perfect man that could look right through me to my soul, that could penetrate and see my heart, my fears, my everything that I had ever been afraid of and had ever wanted, and every prayer that I ever prayed, and every tear that had ever fallen, he saw it. And I saw his sacrifice so that when I got to this point in my life, I could have a new life. And I saw love. I saw the passion, this crazy undying love that I had searched for. I found it in Jesus. And he had sent someone into my life to rescue me. I was baptized soon after that, and the amazing feeling of having a clear conscience. Wow, the peace, the confidence from knowing that my identity is in Christ alone. You know, and the sisterhood that I was given, it was way different than anything I'd ever known. And I had had friends, and I had good friends, to have these deep bonds with sisters that knew me in and out and could care less if I wore makeup or not was awesome. For the last 20 years, Jesus has been my hero, my best friend, my savior, and during these years I've been able to work full-time in the ministry, to study the Bible with other young women who were hurting and searching just like I was, and God gave me this amazing purpose to see lives changed. When I was 6 years old in my baton twirling class and they asked me what I wanted to be when I grew up, I said Miss America. But what God wanted me to be was a disciple of Jesus that changed people's lives. This is my passion now. And then God sent this man of my dreams, the man of God, into my life, the greatest blessing I've ever had, because he desires to get the truth out there to the world. I admire his integrity and purity, and I'm so grateful that I waited and I allowed God to restore purity back to my life. I have 2 daughters now. I love having little women to teach about God, to teach that you don't need false eyelashes and extensions to be beautiful. You, because every woman that God made is beautiful. Every single one. And I wish we felt that. You know, I like teaching them that there's a deep meaning to life. There's a depth, and we have a purpose. You know, I would just say, don't sell yourself short. Don't sell yourself shallow. You know, get it on straight when you're young so that God can show you his dream for your life.
And so there I was on my walk, trying to figure out what to do with my life. And I made a decision. I said, you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to start praying, and I'm going to try to read my Bible, and I'm going to try to go to church twice a month. That's just where I was. I got to be honest. I'm just being real. You know what I mean? It's a process. And quite honestly, I actually wrote a contract to myself, and I wrote those things down. And I signed it, and I dated it, that I was going to do those things. And I started doing them. And I was at a coffee shop in Manhattan Beach, and this guy named Steve Lounsbury came in with his wife, Karen. And they walked into that coffee shop, and Steve started up a conversation with me. And that began a journey to really get into the scriptures. And Steve taught me the Word of God. For the first time in my life, I was broken about my heart and broken about who I was and what I had done. And I took responsibility for all of those decisions and for never taking the time to clean the inside of my cup. And then finally realizing that even if I wanted to clean the inside of my cup, I could never do it on my own. That only Jesus can clean the inside of my cup and make me whole and make me pure. Foundation of Jesus, and you will never wake up in the middle.